جنودا نجوب الوهاد نمضي أسودا لا نخشى الوغاد نمضي جنودا نمضي أسودا نمضي جنودا نمضي أسودا نمضي جنودا نجوب الوهاد نمضي أسودا لا نخشى الوغاد نمضي جنودا نجوب الوهاد نمضي أسودا لا نخشى الوغاد نمضي جنودا نمضي أسودا نمضي جنودا.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق محمد بن عبد الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل الله فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا صلوات الله وسلامه عليه عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، all praise is due to Allah. We praise Him, seek His help, and seek His forgiveness. We seek refuge in Allah from the evil of ourselves and the evil of our actions. Whomever Allah guides, none can misguide. And whomever Allah leads astray, none can guide. And I bear witness that there is no God or deity worthy of worship but Allah alone. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his servant and messenger. And I bear witness that Jesus, peace be upon him, is his servant and messenger. And I bear witness that Moses, peace be upon him, is his servant and messenger. Brothers and sisters in Islam, please be patient with us tonight due to the microphone problem. Tonight's lecture is essential. Reason being is many Muslims are indulging and they have unfortunately been influenced by some of these magicians. Reading cups, reading palms, believing that some people know the unknown. Tonight's lecture is essential and we need to focus on this because many Muslims have been harmed and they have been tricked by many of those people who claim that they know the unknown and they have some type of gift. Today we would like to talk about another creation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created, and they are called al-jinn. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in al-Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Indeed, I have created jinn and mankind only that we may worship Allah. Jinn and mankind. The reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us is to worship Him alone. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it clear that human beings and the jinn have been created for that main purpose, is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The jinn, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that they have been created from baked clay. خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ صَلْصَالٍ كَالْفَخَّارِ وَخَلَقَ الْجَانَّ مِنْ مَارِجٍ مِنْ نَارٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created mankind from soil, from dirt. And He has created jinn from baked, from fire. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it clear that the same purpose that we have been created for, another creation, they have been created for the same reason. And they are called al-jinn. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that the malaika have been created from nur, from light. And the jinn have been created from fire. Also, the Prophet, peace be upon him, has said, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ الْجِنْ ثَلَاثَةْ أَصْنَافٍ مِنْهُمْ صِنْفْ لَهُمْ أَجْنِحَةٍ يُطِيرُونَ فِي الْهَوَاءِ وَصِنْفْ حَيَّاتٍ وَعَقَارِبٍ وَصِنْفْ يُحِلُّونَ وَيَضْعَنُونَ. The Prophet has said that there is three types of jinn. One of them, one type, they do fly. And the others, they shape themselves in snakes and spiders. And the others, they reside in houses. And we need to realize that the jinn, as there is good mankind, there is bad mankind. The jinn are exactly the same. The jinn are exactly the same. There are some that are Muslims, rebellious Muslims, good Muslims. And there are some that are Christians, good character, and bad Christians, as there is with human being. So there is no difference between mankind and jinn. The difference is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him a favor that he has not given us, which they can see us and we can't see them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in Al-Quran, إنه الشيطان إنه يراكم هو وقبيله من حيث لا ترونهم. Shaitan, he sees you, him and his tribe, from a position that you can't see them. So they can see us. They could be present with us today. They could be amongst us today. Inshallah, good jinn. And they are here for the same purpose as you are today, to benefit by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يقول الشافعي رحمة الله تعالى عليه يقول من زعم أنه يرى الجن فأبطلنا شهادته إلا أن يكون نبيا. الشافعي, one of the greatest scholars, رحمة الله عليه, he has said, whomever says that they have seen the jinn, we have made him, we don't accept him as a witness, except if he's a prophet. Now we know that many people do see the jinn, especially if they've been possessed or whatever. They do see the jinn, but they see them not in their original form, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that you will not see them. You will see them in a different form. They shape in spiders, they shape in snakes, they shape in human beings. And many of those people who I've read on and they have been possessed, they see them as short, long ears, bald, and things like this. They form themselves in that particular form. But this is not their original form. So, Al-Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi has made it clear that no one, whomever claims that they can see the jinn in their original form, that we don't accept them as a witness. يقول المولى عز وجل يا معشر الإنس والجن ألم يأتكم رسل منكم يقصون عليكم آياتي وينذرونكم لقاء يومكم هذا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, or jinn and mankind, have you not been warned when I have sent the messengers to you, so they can warn you to that day? This is the day of judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will address mankind and jinn, telling them that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent messengers to warn you about this particular day, the day of judgment. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that the jinn would say, وَأَنَّا مِنَّا الصَّالِحُونَ وَمِنَّا دُونَ ذَلِكَ. And the jinn would say that there are good, that there are jinns, they are righteous, and there are those who are rebellious. And many of us believe that a shaitan, he is from the malaika. No, a shaitan, he is from the jinn. And we all have read Surah Al-Kahf, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, وإذ قلنا للملائكة اسجدوا لآدم فسجدوا إلا إبليس كان من الجن. كان من إيش؟ من الجن. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He said that the angels prostrate to Adam, they all prostrated except Iblis. He was of the jinn. Now many people are confused about the jinn. The jinn, as I said previously, they are like human beings. There are good jinn and there are bad jinn. But the bad jinn, the disbelievers jinn, we call them shayateen. As sometimes if your son misbehaves, you'd say to him, sit down, ya shaitan. Huh? Or a person, he's rebellious and he's a transgressor. Okay, you would say this person is a shaitan because of his behavior. So the jinn are originally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created them from fire. And the ones who transgress and disbelieve in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are shayateen. Now, some people disbelieve that a jinn can enter inside a body. They can possess a body. Let us at the moment begin with the book of Allah. As we are Muslims, whenever there's an argument and dispute in anything, we have, alhamdulillah, the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in Al-Quran, فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. If you have an argument or dispute in anything, then take it back to Allah, the book of Allah, and Rasulih, and the messenger, the sunnah, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. And keep this in mind, please. Whenever you have a dispute in anything, make sure that you take it back to the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the understanding of the sahaba. How do we understand the book of Allah? When we read and we find that the meaning of this verse of the Quran is as Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu has understood it, and Umar, and Abdullah ibn Abbas, and Ali radiallahu anhu, and the rest of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu. If we hold on to this, we'll never go astray. Understand Islam according to the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu. If each one of us, we give him a Quran today and we tell him, understand Quran the way you think or according to your own intelligence, we will have a major problem. But we need to understand Quran as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam understood it, and also the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And why do we specifically say that always go back to the best of generations? Because first of all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with them. As He has said in Al-Quran, radiyallahu anhum wa radu an. Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Allah. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, khayrul qurun qarni thumma alladhina yalunahum thumma alladhina yalunahum. The best of generation is my generation. Then the following one, then the following one. So always when there's an argument or dispute, take it back to the righteous Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum and those who follow them in righteousness. Al-Qurtubi rahmatullahi alayhi has said, these verses, the verses that I'm going to recite inshallah, which is الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ الرِّبَى لَا يَقُومُونَ إِلَّا كَمَا يَقُومُ الَّذِي يَتَخَبَّطُهُ الشَّيْطَانُ مِنَ الْمَسِ يَتَخَبَّطُهُ الشَّيْطَانُ مِنَ الْمَسِ. Al-Qurtubi rahmatullahi alayhi has said, these verses contains proof of the incorrectness of those who deny possession by way of the jinn, claiming that this is the result of a natural causes, as well as those who claim that Satan does not enter humans or does not touch them. This is whom? Al-Qurtubi. And At-Tabari said similar things. He said, mind you, you'll find this in volume 3, page 355. At-Tabari rahmatullahi alayhi has said also, he whom we have so described in this life will rise up in the next life from his grave like one stumbling from Shaitan's touch. Now let us look at a hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This sahabi, his name is Ya'la ibn Murra radiyallahu ta'ala an. He said, I was on a journey with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And on the way, a woman came to the Prophet, peace be upon him. And she said to him that this boy, this little boy that she's got, her son, afflicted with a trial. And from him we have also been afflicted with a trial. I do not know how many times per day he is seized by fits. He said, give him to me, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. So the Prophet ﷺ took that young boy. He opened his mouth. He spat inside the mouth of that young boy. And he said, Bismillah, ana abdullah, ya Allah. Al-ubudiyya, ya akhwan. Bismillah, ana abdullah, ukhraj ya adu Allah. Prophet Muhammad ﷺ has said, in the name of Allah, because the Prophet ﷺ, he is like us. He can't blink an eye, nor do anything without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's will. He said, in the name of Allah, I am the slave. He was honored to say that I am the slave of Allah. He said, ukhruj ya adu Allah, leave all you, the enemy of Allah. That's what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said. And he said to this woman, we are going to go on a journey. And when we do come back, we would like to see you here. And when the Prophet, peace be upon him, went on a journey and came back, she said, by he who has sent you with the truth, nothing has happened to him since. This hadith is found in Rawahu Ahmad and Al-Hakim and Al-Tahawi. And also, عن أبي حسن الأشعري في الإبانة يقول مقالات أهل السنة والجماعة أنهم يقولون إن الجن تدخل في بدن المسروع. One of the greatest scholars, may Allah have mercy on him, أبي حسن الأشعري has said, the sayings of the people of Sunnah, this is an agreement, it is consensus, this is the saying, that they believe that the jinn enters inside a body. Also, among the many statements from classical scholars confirming the reality of possession is that Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi alayhi, he said, his son came up to him and he said, he asked him that there are some people who claim that the jinn cannot enter the body of a human being. Ahmad ibn Hanbal, one of the greatest scholars, may Allah have mercy on him, has said. He said, he replied, oh my dear son, they are lying. For that is on jinni speaking with his tongue. So whomever said, and they have knowledge, and they claim that the jinn, the spirit, does not enter inside a body, know that when this person is speaking, the shaitan is speaking through his mouth. And Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi has said, expressed the position of the majority of scholars stating the existence of the jinn is an established fact. According to the book, the Quran, and the Sunnah, and the agreement of the early scholars, likewise the penetration of a jinn into a human body is also an established fact according to the consensus of leading scholars. It is also a fact witnessed and experienced by anyone who reflects on it. The jinn enters the one seized by fits and causes him or her to speak incomprehensible words, unknowing to himself. If he or she, once seized by fits, is struck a blow sufficient to kill a camel, they don't feel it. Wallahi al-azim, I have seen this in my own eyes. Once I went to a mosque. I've made an appointment with a brother. This brother, may Allah forgive him, had a girlfriend. She was Jewish. His father rang me and told me there's something wrong with my son. Could you please see him? So we went inside the mosque And when I came, I've realized that there was a girl inside the car. When I walked inside the mosque, I said, and it was obviously about 10 o'clock at night. I said, who is that girl inside the car? The brother said, she's my girlfriend. I said, bring her in. She went inside the mosque. She put the hijab. And I started to recite Quran on him. Once I started to recite Al-Quran on him, his body started to shake. He started to speak in Hebrew. And his wife sitting down, she's shocked and she's amazed. She knows him well. She's been with him for 3 years. And she never heard him say a word of Hebrew. The spirit that was in him was a Jew. And the person who did that magic was her family, because they did not want him. Anyway, there are things that I can't tell you, but inshallah, I did use a type of force that if someone was to do what I've done to that person, if someone did what I've done to this person, to me, I can assure you I'll be crying for days. I've hit that person on his feet. As I said, if someone was to hit me the same way I'd hit him, I would not walk probably for a week or two. He did not feel a thing. Subhanallah al-Azim. So this is a reality that we must face and we must believe in. And inshallah, in time, I will give you other examples that did take place. A person who's had a curse on them or they've been bewitched could die. It all depends on the magic that has been done to them. Al-Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi and Ahmad ibn Hanbal, they've said the position that they have is a person who does a certain magic, whether it's by smoke or by something that you drink or eat or by something that you wear, it will affect you. And Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi has said, no, it doesn't have to. A magic can be done with you being in another country or another area. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said this in Al-Quran. يُفَرِّقُونَ بِهِ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَزَوْجِهِ. They cause separation between man and his wife. Man and his wife. And you will find the majority of time that magic which is done, unfortunately, you will find to divide the man and woman. There's a lot of envious out there. So a person would go to this magician and would say that I want them to be divided, this husband and wife. And this magician, he will create or prepare a certain formula, whether it's by something that, whether it's by something a person will drink, or something that they will wear, or by taking a hair of their body, any of that, magic can be done through it. And you will find these magicians and fortune tellers, the first thing that they will ask of you is your mother's surname. And this is a fact. And once the shaitan waits for that opportunity to enter inside the body, and it takes him a while, and they wait for these three opportunities. Extreme anger. And when a person has a great temptation and desire, and وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ, also when a person becomes insane, this is an opportunity for the jinn to enter inside the body. Now if this magic has been done on the male or the female to break up, suddenly he or she will dislike their partner. She sees him or he sees her as an evil person in front of them. When he's around her, he dislikes her. He can't wait to leave that house. And this is, I'm talking about two different personalities. You would know if a person has had magic by having two split personalities. 1 minute they are calm, and the next minute they can hate that person so much. Also, some of the symptoms that you'll find with a person that has been possessed is seeing bad dreams during the night. Spiders, snakes, fire, seeing themselves falling from high places. And it all depends on the actual magic. It could be done for many reasons. It could be done for example, for a sister, that whenever she sees someone who proposes for her, asks for her hand for marriage, she would dislike him. This does happen. And sometimes you will find that couple can't have children because of magic. Because the Satan goes inside the body and they run with the blood. And for those people who have had magic, you will find that they feel something running up and down. And one of the questions that I usually ask those people is, do you feel extreme numbness in your fingertips and your feet? Extreme pain in the stomach? Migraines? Lower back pains? They are the symptoms that you'll find. Lack of sleep? Extreme anger? Extreme anger to an extent where a person, if a person was to tell you, listen, you've just broke someone's nose, or you did certain things, a certain action that you can't recall, this is also a sign of a person that is possessed or has got magic. You hear things, you feel the presence of things, you hear voices do something to yourself or whatever. And alhamdulillah, this is all by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That in Melbourne, I used to visit the psychiatric hospitals. And alhamdulillah, three Muslims that have been going there for almost 8 years or so, alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, He has given them a cure. Utilizing the Quran, inshaAllah. Making sure that they read the Quran, implement what is inside the Quran, and I was there to help them by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see, many of us read the Quran and not understand it. And that's one of the problems why we seem to not concentrate and to feel like our faith is not strengthening, because we don't understand what we read. وَمِن شَرِّ النَّفَّاثَاتِ فِي الْعُقَدِ. When a person recites this, they are seeking from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refuge from the evil shaitan, from the shaitan that, وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ, the shaitan which is used to blow the knots. And we need to realize that for a magician to be a magician, they will have to do a lot of things which are forbidden, a lot of kufr acts. You see, who helps the magician are the shayateen, Satans. So this person would have to pray to them, sacrifice for them, go inside the toilets with the Quran in their, while they put the Quran in their private parts. They will do all these miserable things. They are the worst of people. They are the worst of people. For that reason, Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, and Malik and Ahmad ibn Hanbal has said to kill the magician. And at the time of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anh, he killed the three magicians because they tear families apart. They destroy people. But unfortunately, brothers and sisters, today they are respected amongst the community. If you were to open up any newspaper today, whether it's local, state, wherever you are, you will find these people, so-called righteous people, healers. These people are dangerous. And they claim that they can give a cure. Once I was at a place which I've been called in an area called Coburg in Melbourne. And I was called, but at the same time there was a magician there. So I went there and I've seen him. He has already arrived. And there were actually Christians, the people who've called me. Christian Lebanese. So I went inside and I've seen this magician. And there's about 7-8 people sitting around this woman holding her while her body is shaken. She had to have 7 people to hold her. That's how strong the spirit that was inside of her body. And this lying magician, he has took $3,000 from her. And he was giving her a drink, which is the color of a blood, and it could be blood. And this magician, he claims that he's a Muslim. And he had an old book that he was reciting from. So I was there for a period of time and I said to the people, listen, allow me to read for half an hour and I have to go. So they said, okay. So I said to those people who are holding this woman, I said, leave her alone. So she sat beside me and I put a pillow on top of her head and I started to recite Al-Quran. In the meantime, there was a bit of confrontation between me and that magician. That magician was calling spirit to come inside of her body and to kick out the spirit which is in her. And I said to the people, that there was about 20 people present, I said, this person is a magician and he's a liar. And that's what he's doing at the moment. That is what he's doing at the moment. So this magician said to me, I will blind you now. I said, do it. But I said to him, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُدَافِعْ عَنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Allah protects those who believe. So when I started to recite the Quran on her, she started to shake. So I grabbed the belt and I hit her on her feet for about 5 minutes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after these 5 minutes, has given her a cure. She looked at me like this and she said, who are you? What are you doing here? She was unconscious right through the ordeal. Wallahi al-azim. And the people ran to me. They said, you gave her the cure. I said, no. I said, no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is the one who gives cure. Not me or Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All the sheikhs around the world, if they were to get together, they will not be able to give anyone a cure. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, he's the one who gives the cure. And there are people at the moment, unfortunately, that are using this as business. You will find in many of these newspapers that these people will claim that they know the unknown. If you were to pay $30 or $40, they will let you know that what's going to happen to you in the future. Subhanallah. And what surprises me is many Muslims believe in this. Many Muslims believe in fortune tellers. Have we not heard what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam has said? Have we not heard? مَنْ أَتَى كَاهِنًا أَوْ عَرَّافًا فَصَدَّقَهُ بِمَا يَقُولُ فَقَدْ كَفَرَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ. Have we not heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam when he said, whomever comes to a magician or a fortune teller and they believe in what they say, they have disbelieved on what was revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which is Al-Quran, which is Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. Have we not heard? How can you believe these magicians? How can you believe these fortune tellers? How could they sit with you for an hour and take your $40? If they knew the unknown, why wouldn't they go and fill up a Tatslara number and win few million dollars? Why? And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam has said, لو كنت أعلم الغيب لاستكثرت من الخير وما مسني السوء. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, and if I knew the unknown, I would have an abundance of good and no harm would have affected me. لا يعلم غيب السماوات والأرض إلا الله. None knows the unknown in the heavens and the earth except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whomever comes up to you and tells you that this is going to happen tomorrow or whatever, know that they are lying. And they are not worthy of listening to. We find, unfortunately, today that many Muslims, they indulge. They go out there and they get some this so-called good luck charm, believing that it will protect them from the eye or from shaitan. A'udhu billahi min hadha. Have we not heard Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which he said, "Man 'allaqa tamima faqad ashrak." Whomever hangs anything and they believe that this will protect them, they have made shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you hang this kharz al-zarqa, this so-called blue eye things that people have, or wal-'ayyadu billah, some called, and you'll find this in many Muslim countries, a book which is called Al-Husn al-Haseen, which one of the brothers, may Allah reward, has given me now. This book you will find the majority of Muslims have, and I've seen it being sold in some Islamic countries, probably not knowing or not, you know, realizing the danger of this book. First of all, unfortunately, the page that I want is not here, but this is the first page that you'll find on your left hand side. Has anyone got one of these books? Al-Husn al-Haseen. Anyone's got one of those? Can you please give it to me if you have? I'd appreciate it. No. Okay. The first page on your left hand side. Alhamdulillah. The first page that you will find on the left hand side of that book, it has four satanic names. The first page on your left hand side, it's got Kamdham, Qaswara, Tail, and Afil. This is the first page on your left hand side, and you will see a formula of magic numbers. Now, on the right hand side, it says here, it's not the book that I want. The book says, and as I said, this is the most held book by the Muslims. Many Muslims have that book. Okay? And it says, حَدَّثَنَا بَعْضَ الْعَارِفِينَ. A person has informed us, a person that who knows, that whomever carries this book, if they are poor, they become rich. If they are sick, they become cured. If they are in prison, they will be free. They will enter the doors of the kings, whomever carries it. Who has informed them? A person that they claim that he knows. You see, and also you will find in the book, which is called Al-Husn al-Haseen, you will find that there are some Quran chapters so they can fool Muslims. So they can fool Muslims. I have also something that I've picked up from a sister that was sick the other day, which said, وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ, other satanic names. You will find, yeah, I think that's the book. Can I have it, please? Jazakallah khair. Jazakallah khair. This is the book. You will find it in the majority of Muslims' homes. I don't know if the brothers or sisters can see it from here. There are numbers on this side. And on each corner, you will find these things. And you will find on the right-hand side, as I was saying previously. طيب. يقول فقد استخرت الله سبحانه وتعالى وجمعت هذا الحصن الحصين من كتاب رب العالمين وهو حرز نافع إن شاء الله تعالى لكل شيء خصوصا من الأمراض التي تحصل لبني آدم وبنات حواء دخول على على الملوك وأرباب الأقلام والمجبة والقبول، ونافع للسفر وكيد الفجار، وتبطل السحر، ونافع من لدغة العقرب والحية والثعبان، لأنه قد حدثنا بعض العارفين. That's the person here that says one person told us and informed us that whomever carries this book, it will be beneficial for all those things that I've mentioned before. لأنه قد حدثنا بعض العارفين عن جده, that his grandfather has told him أن هذا الدعاء ما حمله معسر إلا يسره الله. His grandfather has told him, whomever carries this supplication, this book, whatever difficulties that they're going through, they will have peace and ease. إلا يسر الله رزقه ولا خائف إلا أمنا ولا مريض إلا شفيا ولا مديون إلا قضى الله دينه ولا مسجون إلا فك من سجنه ولا مهموم ومغموم ومكروب إلا انصرف عن كربه. So his grandfather told this person, whomever carries this book, if they are going through difficulties in provision, things will become easier. And whomever is frightened, they will have that sense of security. And whomever is sick, they will be cured. And whomever has taken a loan, they will be able to pay it back. And whomever is in prison, they will be released. This is shirk. If you believe in this, that if you were to carry this, and this will protect you, and this will give you the cure, and this will make you rich, you are committing the same thing as the Christians are doing with Jesus, peace be upon him, and as, وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ, the disbelievers, those who believe in the statues and idols. This is forbidden. And I have another piece of paper that I took out of a sister the other day that says, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ مَا شَاءَ اللَّهِ نَلُّوش لَيُّوش عيوش مردوش فتوش قردوش حشوش لاحوش دروش أم الصبيان لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم وصلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. I know that there are many sisters out there that have similar things. Rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to put our trust and confidence in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أذهب البأس رب الناس واشفي أنت الشافي. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say, أذهب البأس رب الناس. O Allah, the Lord of mankind, remove the pain. واشفي أنت الشافي. Give a cure. None can give the cure except for you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لا شفاء إلا شفاءك. There is no cure but your cure. We need to put our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In none of this. Wallahi al-azim, brothers and sisters, the biggest enemy that the Muslims face today is ignorance, lack of knowledge. You see, we are expert in everything almost. But when it comes to the religion, the majority of us don't know how to pray or make wudu or whatever. Whomever comes who looks like me, long beard, mashallah, he's got long abaya, anything that this person says, you believe without questioning, without confirming that this person, whatever he's saying, it is from the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. For that reason, the Muslim ummah today is in this situation. People would say, don't talk bad about this person. He knows the unknown. Subhanallah al-Azim. There was a person in Lebanon that people used to go to his grave and they used to seek assistance from him and they used to slaughter for him and they used to donate. But that grave was in the middle of the road and they had to make that road. But people used to say, if anyone was to touch this grave, there will be harm, them and their family. So one of the shaykhs who, alhamdulillah, feed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he had full trust and reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, I will demolish that grave. So the shaykh decided to get an axe and start to demolish this grave. He found an ID, identification card for that person. He was a Greek person, a Greek hunter, who landed in Lebanon, and the people said, well, why don't we bury him here? So the problem is they were seeking help and assistance from a dead person. And they thought he's a wali. He's a person who's righteous. And they interceded through him to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they found out that he's a Greek person, he's not a Muslim. And these people have been fooled. Ignorance is a major problem. We need to realize this. We need to come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be dependent on Allah in everything. And one of the reasons why the Muslims today are in this situation, because they put their trust in someone else besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do we not know when a person leaves their house, they make full insurance with Allah? A person asks me, is insurance permissible, Abu Hamza? I would say, yes, of course. When you leave the house, you say, Bismillah, tawakkaltu ala Allah, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. When you leave the house, you say, Bismillah, in the name of Allah, tawakkaltu ala Allah, I depend on Allah, I put my trust in Allah, la hawla. There is no might or power except by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, when a person makes dua, this dua in the morning, the shaitan who is waiting for him outside or waiting for her would say, I have no chance of having any effect or influence on that person. Rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what we need to do. And unfortunately, we seem to put the Quran in many houses today. You'll find, mashallah, you would go to, you know, one of the brother's house or one of the sister's house, and you'll find, mashallah, they've got about 6-7 Qurans, or sometimes 10 and 15. And they all look neat, mashallah, because none of them have been opened. This Quran, brothers and sisters, is to be opened and to recite and to implement. You see, in my country, Lebanon, see, I can mention my country, but I won't mention someone else's country. When a person recites the Quran, or a person puts a tape to listen to the Quran, people would knock on the door and say, Khair inshallah, someone has died? The Quran has become, unfortunately, it has been used only for the dead. هذا القرآن حفظكم الله لينذر من كان حيا. This Quran, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, it is to warn those who are alive, not those who are dead. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. We descend what is in the Quran, which is shifa, cure, and merciful to those who believe. In another verse, قُلْ هُوَ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا هُدًى وَشِفَاءٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in Al-Quran, say, O Muhammad, to the people, say to them, it is hudan, it is guidance. This Quran, this miracle that is left on the face of the earth today is the last miracle. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has challenged those who disbelieve at the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to make like the Quran, a Quran or 10 surah or even one surah, and they weren't able. And this challenge remains till the day of judgment. This is the miracle that is left on the face of the earth today, Al-Quran. It is guidance and a cure to mankind. Wallahi al-Azim, I have read on people who are disbelievers, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him a cure. Once I read on a person who's from Yugoslav, and I started to recite the Quran, and he became unconscious. So I read on a bit of water, and I've opened up his mouth, and as soon as I put a bit of water in his mouth, he started to shiver, and his mouth started to go up and down like this in an extreme speed. I've never seen it like this. And there was no one else besides me and him. So alhamdulillah, this is an advantage. So I got up, grabbed the belt, and started to lay into him. Wallahi al-Azim. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after about 15 minutes of belting the hell out of him, on his feet. Wallahi al-azim, wallahi al-azim. He became conscious and he said, what happened? He is not aware. He is not aware of what happened. You see, I've been reading on people who've been possessed for about 8 years. The first year that I've began, even though that I was learning prior to that, I was watching some of the brothers who've got some expertise in this. The first year that I began, one of the brothers that I used to teach, he said that his sister is sick. And whenever she puts the hijab on, she dislikes it. Can I come to their house and read the Quran? So I went. This is my first time, and I was by myself. So I started to read on this sister. Suddenly the mother was beside her. She started to shake. And no, brothers and sisters, if you, this is one of the symptoms that proves that you are possessed or you have someone has put a magic on you, is when you listen to the Quran, you become cranky and upset and frustrated. And you have problems sleeping, especially after Maghrib until Fajr. This is the time that you find difficulties in sleeping. So I started to recite the Quran, and the mother was on the left hand side, and she started to shake angrily like this, and I found out that the mother is possessed. I started to read on the mother. I looked behind me, one of the brother's brothers, he said, there's something in my hand, and he started to shake like this. Wallahi al-azim. After 3 weeks of reading on these people, alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them both cure. It is all mercy from Allah. Through the Quran. The Quran, this miracle that many of us have neglected and they have left aside. We need to understand this. This is a cure. This is medication, al-Quran. And we should not utilize it for the wrong reason and just decorate it. The Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has favored us with to implement and to recite. And also, we need to realize that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, "Inna ar-ruqa wa at-tama'im wa at-tawlata shirk." Rawahu Ahmad wa Abu Dawud. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that ar-ruqa, you see, if you want to find that a person, he's doing the right thing, if you have been possessed or someone has put a spell or whatever, make sure that this person has these features. First of all, if he was to say to you that I'm coming, especially to a sister, make sure that he asks you, is your husband there, your brother, your uncle, your grandfather? If he was to say, yes, I would come, and there is no one else besides you and him, know that this person is evil. There are two people in Melbourne that have been jailed, alhamdulillah. And I will mention their name because I don't fear them. And there are a few here at the moment that I'm trying to get their name. One of them came to Melbourne recently. He took $9,000 of his sister. Okay? You know, saying that he will bring her husband back to her. So he rang her husband and he said, please just come back with her just for one night. Anyway, these two evil people, one of them, his name is Omar Sharif, and he ain't no Sharif. He's not Sharif. He's a Nusayri, he's Alawi. That person, women used to come from all around Australia to him. And they used to line up. And wal'ayyadu billah, he has committed adultery with many of the sisters. And mashallah, you'll find some of the brothers, you know, coming with their wives or their sisters. And the person would say, wait outside. He would say, okay, not a problem. And he will get her inside. And wal'ayyadu billah, he does evil things. Even though that he deals with spirits, evil spirits, that will go inside of her body and she will become unconscious. She's not aware of what he's doing. But when she would get up from this ordeal, she would feel that something has happened. So that clown has been jailed, alhamdulillah, in Melbourne. And also there are a few. A'udhu billahi min ghadabillah. So make sure that person, he fears Allah. And they only recite Al-Quran and they read some of the dua of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Make sure they read loudly because they could be calling spirits. And also make sure that they, the dua that they can make is a dua that is permissible. Because the Prophet ﷺ has said, لا بأس بالرقى ما لم تكن شركا. There is nothing wrong with reading on a person who is sick as long as there's no shirk in it. So a person can say, نسأل الله عز وجل أن يشفيها ويبعد عنها شياطين الإنس والجن. You know, you can make a dua that you can, whatever dua that you want to, as long as you are not making shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's an incident that happened that one of the sisters came from Sydney to Melbourne. And subhanallah al-azim, this is something that really, you know, opened my eyes and it had a lot of effect on me. When she was here, they took her to the hospital because she was running after her little daughter. She wanted to kill her. Suddenly she dislikes her husband. So they took her to a doctor. They've examined her and everything else. And they found that there's nothing wrong with her. So they brought her to Melbourne. And I was called to go there. And I was with another brother then. Before I walked in, this sister has said to her family that this person by name is coming in and this person by name is coming in. Wallahi al-azim. She knew who is going to come to that house. Because the spirits are like us. As I inform you, they inform one another. So we went inside that house and we said to the sister, please put on the hijab. Please put on head cover, head scarf. And she said, I don't want to. In this tone of language. So I said, okay. In these circumstances, she's sick. Let her go. So I started to recite Al-Quran on her. And by Allah, what I'm saying is the truth. After half an hour, the body started to shake. So I said, Bismillah, in the name of Allah, who is with me? And her family is sitting down around her. A male voice came out from her voice, saying, my name is Stephen. I said, what are you doing here? He said, I have come here to make sure that she hates her husband and dislikes her child. So I started to speak to this jinn for about half an hour about Islam. And by Allah, who has created me and you, he said, I want to embrace Islam. Then I decided to ask him what name he would like to choose. And he said to me, you choose a name for me. So I've called him Umar radiallahu ta'ala an. So those people who dislike Umar can keep away from him. Radiallahu ta'ala an. And then she's still being affected by this. So I read again. Again the body shook. And I told him to leave. And he left, and they usually leave through the feet or through the hands. And again, this is something, as you have, you know, people who are expert in certain things. Also, when a person needs, if they want to recite on people who've been possessed, they need to also be experts because they could be harmed or their family. Because the shayateen, they're like us. You harm me, I am going to harm you. If you hit my child, I'm going to send an army to hit you or whatever. They have the same mentality. And they will take revenge. So those people who read, they have to make sure that the dua, the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always on their tongue. And they're always making the dua that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to use. And making sure that their children and their families do the same thing. So after a period of time, I started to recite again. And I said, in the name of Allah, who's with me? He said, my name is Stefan. I said, Stefan, what are you doing here? He said, I have come to the same reason. I said, you heard what I said to Umar. Do you like me to talk about Islam? He said, I hate Islam. I dislike Islam. I said, this is up to you. But I ask you in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to leave this body. Wallahi al-azim. We all cried in that room. As soon as this evil spirit left the body, this sister of ours ran to her daughter and she started to cry and hug her daughter. And alhamdulillah, their lives have been wonderful after that. So that there are evil people out there that enjoy when people have been harmed. وَالْعِيَادَ بِاللَّهِ. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from all evil.